How did New Zealand's wealthiest school become the centre of one of the country's biggest sexual abuse cases? At the boys-only boarding school Dilworth, hundreds of students suffered serious abuse over three decades. What's more, they say the school went out of its way to cover it up. Tonight, Marva Mo'ayed is with survivors who, for the first time, reveal what truly happened under the guise of spiritual and educational care. And a warning, this investigation contains some confronting themes.
Dilworth, a school that had a sparkling reputation and a noble goal: to take in disadvantaged children and give them education, faith and opportunity.
I thought he was a man of God. And then he proceeded to place his hand on my thigh and start putting up my pants.
We were encouraged to use the bathroom next door if we wanted to do anything more without clothes.
It began with, you know, him touching and grooming me. It accelerated quickly into rape.
The school that promised these boys so much instead took everything from them.
They had all these values that they were going to instill in our boys. But what came home was none of it. I had a destroyed soul come home.
After years of silence, these men are choosing to reveal the details of their abuse. They want Dilworth to be held accountable.
Just for so long, I thought that something was wrong with me.
And that's the most damaging thing about this, is the fact that the sexual abuse of these boys was needless, and the school knew it was happening.
You can't take away what's happened, but you can own up and admit the cover-up. And these guys have lied, and they've lied, and they're lying still.
Nestled in the heart of Auckland's Remuera is a century-old boarding school. Its founders were James and Isabella Dilworth, a childless couple who left behind their property fortune and a lofty vision.
To bring in young boys, very young boys, who were orphans or sons of people in straitened circumstances, mould them and turn them out as good and useful citizens.
The school's produced impressive alumni, including this straight-talking, smooth-voiced broadcaster.
Radio Lollipop, we're raising money for the Auckland Children's Hospital.
If you had the radio and TV on in the 80s and 90s, you might remember him, Mark Stalfer.
I love telling other people's stories, so it's been weird telling my story, you know? God, it's been tough.
Now living in Amsterdam, he's a storyteller who, for decades, has kept his own story secret.
Why have you decided to do this interview?
I'm in my 50s now, so I kind of can talk about it. But there are those who didn't even get to the age of 50. They killed themselves. It was too painful for them, you know? So when that sort of stuff happens, you realise you've got to make a stand, right?
Mark was 9 when he started at Dilworth.
Dilworth was a constant source of dread for me. There was no escape from it. It was 24/7. If you were singled out, it became, you know, a day full of dread and a night full of horror. We were easy pickings, right? Because we needed love and we needed attention.
He was 12 when he met the school chaplain.
To have someone to take an interest in you as that sort of vulnerable kid is really potent. And he just seemed like the first, you know, decent male who'd ever paid attention to me.
Reverend Peter John Taylor, hired by Dilworth in 1976 on the recommendation of the Anglican Church.
The abuse was gradual, and mostly it was cloaked within biblical and religious ideas. His whole thing was that, you know, Jesus and the disciples had a very close relationship, much closer than we've led to believe.
Mark, this is a hard question, but what did Peter Taylor do to you?
It began with, you know, him touching and grooming me and, you know, trying to kiss me. And although I can't really talk about it here, otherwise I'll probably fall apart, It accelerated quickly into rape.
He do it, says Mark, here, the altar of the school chapel.
There's such a feeling of humiliation when it comes down to it, that I kind of blanked it out and just thought, surely that's it. You know, I'm initiated now. I'm a Christian. It won't happen again. But of course it did happen again and again and again.
I thought he was a man of God. He taught religious education. He was married and young children, so he was sort of beyond reproach, really, despite having a nickname.
Neil, what was his nickname?
Pumper Pete.
Even as a child, Neil Harding had known what a privilege going to Dilworth was.
It was a magnificent opportunity for me. Mm. And I was going to get a wonderful education.
Tell me about your experience there when you first went to the school.
It was a shock. It was a massive culture shock. The only affection or mentoring that I received was grooming. So those staff members that were reaching out saying, you know, I'll look after you, were actually predators.
Neil's lifted his name suppression so that he can share his story. In his 2 years at Dilworth, he says he was preyed on by 3 different men, including Peter Taylor.
He made me sit in the darkest corner of the room, and then he proceeded to place his hand on my thigh, on my right thigh, and start putting up my pants. And the shame and humiliation of not believing that he was Pumper Pete. How stupid was I that I had allowed this man to be close to me.
At school, Neil found solace in the choir. But now that memory haunts him.
It's really sad, because of the innocence of those boys singing that day when that was recorded, and how their lives have been derailed. 2 of the boys that were singing have been abused and have committed suicide.
Did the school know that this was going on?
Yes.
How do you know?
I'm part of it, leading a class action of 130 survivors. And through the information from that the legal team from the class action have got, there's clear evidence that the school knew.
Mark Stauffer agrees. In fact, as a student, he told the headmaster himself that he was being abused.
The headmaster blamed it on me and then called my mother into the school. Now, at this point, I'm going, hallelujah, this is it. They're going to fire, you know, they're going to expel me. I'm going home. They didn't tell her anything about what had happened. They just told her that I was, you know, misbehaving in such a terrible fashion.
Mark was caned, then, he says, put into Peter Taylor's care.
That was his job. They'd appointed him to make sure that I was doing what I was supposed to do. And of course, the rapes continued.
How did you escape the abuse?
So I came up with this plan to call the Sunday News.
Mark found the newspaper's phone number. Then, late one night, he picked up the school's only telephone.
I got as far as, you know, I'm here to report some terrible things going on at an Auckland school. And the tutor swooped in, grabbed the phone. So the next morning, of course, I was dragged in front of the headmaster. But I knew there's no way in the frickin' world they're gonna allow me to stay at the school now, right? They know I mean business. So sure enough, that's what happened. It was the happiest day of my life when I got into my mother's Ford Anglia, as I was like, my God, it's done.
Documents show that in 1978, Dilworth knew at least 5 other students were being abused by Peter Taylor. That number later grew to 10. The school claims it carried out an internal investigation into the offending, but says the report was inexplicably destroyed years later. The police were never called. Instead, minutes from a Dilworth board meeting show Peter Taylor was allowed to quietly resign.
It's just bullshit. It's bullshit. It's bullshit.
Have you heard anyone say, what about the kids that did get a good education and that did get ample opportunities?
Yeah, I mean, that's always the one they throw out, right? Oh, yeah, what are you complaining for? Look at what we're doing for you. We're giving you an education. It might have cost you a bit of ass raping, but hey, you're an accountant now.
Peter Taylor died in 2012, aged 74. If he was alive, police say he'd likely join the list of 12 men already charged with sexual assault at Dilworth.
The entire top echelon of these people knew exactly what was going on and were constantly being informed of this, and they did nothing about it.
When you shut down and don't investigate abuse, it proliferates.
Police launched Operation Beverly in 2019. They've already identified 139 victims at Dilworth, and investigators believe another 96 children were likely abused.
I mean, the whole thing is shocking. I mean, the more you look at this, the worse it gets.
After the break, a mother's crippling guilt.
I have so much regret sending him to Dilworth. So much.
And how the school dealt with a victim just last decade.
Did you feel like the response of the school was to treat you like you were a sexual deviant?
Yeah.
Hi, matey, how are you today?
Good for now, just at the beach.
Every day at 6:30 on the dot, this mum speaks to her son.
I love you.
Since he started using P, simple things like I love you are precious.
He's in a third stint for rehab. And we're just going to have to take each day as it comes and be there for him and support him.
He's chosen not to lift his name suppression, but supports his mum speaking to us.
I feel real guilty as a mum that my son's endured what he's endured. But that guilt doesn't go away. And that's why I chose to do what I've done today.
Her son's now 37. He was accepted to Dilworth as a child after his father died.
It wasn't until his latter years that I noticed some real big changes. There was something inside of me telling me something was wrong, something was not right, but never thinking that he was being sexually molested at school, never.
Reverend Ross Brown. When Chaplain Peter Taylor left Dilworth after abusing a string of boys, Ross Brown was his replacement.
You know, Dilworth is a place where if you need it, you can get a hug or something. You know, it's a place which is that comfortable.
And I used to absolutely loathe the way he cuddled our boys.
Here he is, featured in a documentary about Dilworth in the 90s.
If a kid has an emotional need or whatever, it can be met here.
He wore the cloak for the church, and that was the perpetrator that violated my son and took everything away from him.
Just for so long, I thought that something was wrong with me.
33-year-old Karen Smith is another victim of Ross Brown. He's lifted his name suppression to speak with us.
It was a really hard decision, but ultimately I didn't want to hide.
Every student attends Dilworth for free. The Dilworth Trust holds more than $1 billion in assets. Dilworth is New Zealand's richest school by far.
It's interesting hearing the bell. Does it take you back at all to being in school?
Yeah, a little bit.
Kieran was a model Dilworth boy, a straight A student.
What were your first impressions of Ross Brown?
I remember him being very jolly, I think is a good word to describe him. Very friendly, warm, intelligent. The next time I really spent more time with him was at the crypt.
The crypt was the name of Ross Brown's office. Students would meet there after class to hang out.
At some point, I think there were probably 12 people. We felt special, I think, that we were given a privilege, I think, to join this group that was a little exclusive.
But the crypt had a sinister underbelly. Ross Brown was coaxing boys to kiss and touch while he watched.
Did he ever stand up and say, boys, that's enough?
No, never. And, well, in fact, when we're testing those boundaries, we were encouraged to use the bathroom next door if we wanted to do anything more without clothes.
By who?
Father Brown.
People watching this might say, well, this was the boys themselves. They wanted to do this. You know, is this really Father Brown's fault?
It's a good question. And I think it's something that I've grappled with for a long time. And why it was so hard to come forward. I would ask whether it would ever be acceptable for a teacher to be encouraging sexual activity between children.
In 2006, Ross Brown was suddenly gone. Students were told he'd left for health reasons, but he'd actually quietly resigned after former students complained about his behaviour. With the crypt gone, Kieran went to see the school counsellor.
What did you tell her?
Everything that I've told you today, I suppose. And she referred me to an organisation called SAFE, which is for sexual offenders.
That's right. Instead of supporting him as a victim of sexual abuse, 17-year-old Kieran's counsellor reported him as a sexual deviant.
What was the effect of being treated like a perpetrator?
So legally, I couldn't be around children, which was hard because I lived with my sister, who's 5 years younger than me. So at the time, she had to move. It felt like it was my fault.
SAFE eventually realised the mistake.
That fear of having done something wrong, that persisted a long time. Even though I was told that I shouldn't have been sent to SAFE in the first place.
15 years on, though, Kieran's life is good. He's married, has a great job, and strong relationships with his friends and family. But for this mum and her son, they're still putting the pieces back together.
He could have been so successful in life. He had the brains, he had the ability, he had the personality. The peer addiction is through the trauma he experienced at school.
Last year, Ross Brown pleaded guilty to 15 sexual assault charges involving 14 students. Some of his victims were as young as 11.
I sentence you to 6.5 years imprisonment.
I thought they were going to be giving me back a man.
What have they given you back?
A drug addict through the hands of Ross Brown.
22 students between 1976 and 2007 say they told school staff they were being abused. That means Dilworth had 30 years of knowledge that their boys were being harmed.
Kia ora, fellow old boys.
Earlier this year, the Dilworth Trust Board apologised in this pre-recorded video.
The abuse suffered by old boy survivors in Dilworth's care is and was completely unacceptable. To these men, I say with a heavy heart, Dilworth let you down and we are sorry.
The fact that the school knew we were being abused and didn't stop it exponentially changes things. People in the school made conscious decisions to not investigate, to cover it up, to do the most heinous things, to not stop it.
For more than 2 weeks, we've asked Dilworth's current trust board for an interview. They've declined. Instead, they've sent us this statement.
Our focus is firmly on establishing both an independent inquiry and a redress program. We are committed to confronting the issue of historical abuse openly and honestly. Dilworth School did not adequately ensure the safety of our students, and the past procedures for dealing with allegations of sexual abuse were insufficient. We apologise unreservedly.
Have they ever sat down with you or any of the victims and said, what do you need?
No. They want to control the process. And that's not redress.
Part of that control, says Neil Harding, is Dilworth deciding the value of its victims.
What have they offered?
$200,000. That's for the maximum amount.
Remember, Dilworth is worth more than $1 billion. If it paid 200 victims that maximum redress, it would come to less than 5% of its wealth.
Dilworth needs to sell some of its property and pass it out amongst these kids. A lot of these guys who went through the clutches of Dilworth had it a lot worse than me. They need looking after.
Compensation is important, they say, but so is honesty and accountability.
And I just feel that Dilworth now today is still hiding behind lawyers. I just want them to come forward, apologise to us, meet with us, help us get our sons back.
If you could go back and visit 12, 13-year-old Kieran, what would you say?
I would tell him that you're going to have a really, really tough time, but it's going to be okay. In the end, it's going to be okay.
So brave. Well, Mark Stauffer is currently working on a screenplay, turning his harrowing story into a film. And the man in our story who had his identity hidden just finished rehab and is now 6 months clean.